Hello students, so welcome back to the next series. After learning about the surface roughness, surface texture and surface integrity, now we are going to the next property, which is friction tribology, friction coefficient, wear, wear modes, wear characteristics, etc. So in today's lecture, we are going to start on tribology. So when we talk about tribology, tribology is the science of engineering of interacting surfaces in relative motion. So two of my surfaces, they have interacted when they have touching each other, and then there is a motion between each other, either one is moving or both are moving. So this is called relative motion. So tribology is the field of science in which the surfaces are interacting and they are relatively moving. So what is contained in this science, because this science is very important, because in our everyday life we see different types of interaction of surfaces, such as your car tires are interacting with the road, okay, your knife is interacting with the meat, okay. So there are different scenarios in which the interaction takes place. So every now and then you will see those interaction. Sometimes the friction coefficient is very important, because you need a braking force, etc., to move and to control the movement. However, sometimes the friction force is not desirable, because it causes a lot of exchange and release of energy in the form of heat, etc. So sometimes it is desirable to have control of friction, sometimes it is desirable to have good amount of friction. So what is contained in tribology? Tribology includes basically the study and application of three main things. Number one is friction, number two is wear, and number three is lubrication. In our course, we will be covering friction and wear. So as you can see in the figure as well, that you have got a pushing force, okay. A pushing force is something which want to move the object, whereas a resistive force or another force which wants to resist the motion is the friction force, as you can see. And you can see that the direction of both of them are opposite. It means that the friction force acts in the direction away from the motion or opposite to the motion.
Tribology involves the study of friction, lubrication, and wear between two interacting surfaces and relative motion. We experience this phenomena every day, such as brakes in automobile, cosmetics, and personal care products on our skin, and the consumption of food such as chocolate.
The parameter that quantify the friction between the surface is the coefficient of friction. It is defined by the ratio of the force opposing motion to the force pushing together, which acts perpendicular to the motion.
So let's take a look and let's start the friction topic, which relates to friction coefficient. So what is friction basically? Friction is basically a force which acts opposite and in relation to the opposing force. So here you can see in the figure that the body wants to move in this direction, whereas the limiting or friction force is acting in this direction. Now friction between two of my hands is dry, because there is no lubrication in between. So this is called dry friction or dry sliding friction. This hand is dry, this hand is dry, they are moving relative to each other. So this is called dry sliding friction. Whereas if I put a cream, if I put an oil, and then I am going to do relative motion, then this is wet surface or lubricated surface. So dry sliding friction is one field, and lubricated friction or wet surface friction is another thing. So these are two types of friction in terms of dry and wet. There is another type, which is static and kinetic friction. So what happens in static friction? In static friction, you have got this is my floor and this is my object. Now I want to move this object from rest. So when an object is at rest, then there is a specific amount of friction called static friction acting over it. So in order to move this object, I have to overcome the static friction coefficient. Whereas in kinematic friction, what is happening is that a car is moving, okay, and then I further increases the pedal, or I increase the gas, and then the car moves further more. So in order to overcome the friction for acceleration, the car has to overcome the kinetic friction, something which is moving. Now, kinetic friction is important. Let's say if you want to stop yourself, okay, if you release the accelerator, then what happens is the car slowly, slowly stops. Why it stops? Because the four tires have got kinetic friction, and that kinetic friction force is in the opposing direction, and it is causing the car to stop slowly. So one is static friction, okay, the static friction is something that we need to overcome to move something, whereas kinetic friction is something that when a body is already in motion, then perhaps it has to overcome the kinetic friction between the body and the between the two relative surface. So this is the concept, as you can see in the figures and in the pictures also, what is static and how do you overcome. This man is going to overcome the static friction by moving this box, and this box is stationary, whereas this guy, he has basically jumped to make his run, and now he is sliding, and then the kinetic friction force is basically going to make him stop later on during the once he is sliding, then because of kinetic friction he is going to stop. If he keep on sliding, then he is going to basically abrade his chest. His chest might be abraded. So these are the concepts of different types of friction. So what are the formulas for static friction in order to move a body? Let's say you have got a body, okay, this is a box, and this box is resting, it is on a stationary state, and it is resting on a floor, okay. Then obviously this box has a gravity because it has its weight, so there is a force due to gravity called Fg, okay, and against this force there is a normal force, we say Fn. So this is a normal force Fn. Now I want to push the object, so I'm going to apply a force F so that it moves, and in order to overcome this, it has to overcome the static force which is generated by the friction force, which is the static friction in the opposite direction. So we have got Fs in the opposite direction, this is static friction force, okay. So the formula is that Fs is equals to Fn times friction coefficient in static mu s, where mu s is the coefficient of static friction. So the total amount of static friction is equals to the normal force, okay, acting on the body times the friction coefficient in static. So friction coefficient, if I am going to put it on the next side of the equation, then friction coefficient is equals to the static force Fs whole divided by the normal force Fn. So this is the formula for static friction. Next we talk about kinetic friction for bodies which are already moving. So for a body which is already moving, we have the similar concept that the body is moving, and it is moving in this direction, as you can see the motion direction, and then an opposing force Fk, which is the kinetic force, is acting, okay. So friction coefficient in this case mu k, the kinetic friction force friction coefficient, this is equals to the kinetic force divided by the normal force which is acting on the body away from the force of gravity. So these are the concepts of static friction and kinetic friction. Next we are going to move on to different types of materials. So different types of material, when they interact with each other, they have different kinds of friction coefficient, one static, one kinetic, okay. Let's say I've got rubber and I've got a glass, and I put them together and then I move. So in order to initially start the movement, I will have a coefficient of friction equals to 2 in static, and once it starts moving, then the friction coefficient will remain same as 2. Next we talk about, let's say, metal on metal, okay. So in metal on metal, the static friction is 0.15, but after it moves, the friction reduces and it becomes 0.006, that is very, very low. It means that if I am going to plot a graph, okay, then it will be that initially the static friction is very high with respect to time, friction coefficient with respect to time, okay, then initially it is very high, and later on it will reduce to 0.0006, okay, where this portion is the first high portion is the friction coefficient static region, and the next portion which has reduced, which is the lower portion, is friction coefficient due to kinetic, okay. Same goes for eyes, and you can see the human joints, when you are static and then you want to move from static position, then your friction coefficient is 0.01, and this further reduces to 0.0 to 0.3. So humans and the fluid between the joints of human within my bones, there is fluid between two joints, and that fluid is such a great lubricant, and our bones are such a great material that even their interaction produces very low amount of friction coefficient. That is why we are able to live for 50 years, 70 years, even 100 plus years. So our engineering is so good that normal materials and other materials which occur naturally as well, they also cannot get so less friction coefficient as the one which we have. So we have to study what is going on in us, how our joints are producing so less friction coefficient, and in this way we can learn basically how to reduce friction coefficient for other engineering applications. So this was all about introduction to friction. Now we are going to move to the reasons and theory behind how friction and friction coefficient is generated. So students, now we are going to go into the theory of friction as to why the friction coefficient occurs and what are the reasons behind its occurrence. Okay, so we move on to the theory of friction. Before we move on to the theory of friction, we need to visualize two surfaces. Okay, friction occurs because of two surfaces which are in contact and in relative motion, or either due to static. However, we need to see how those surfaces looks like. When you look at a surface, let's say in this example you've got two surfaces, surface 1 and surface 2, you can see that they are very plain and they are very smooth, and if you put them over each other then there will be no friction or something like that. However, this is not the case. If you're going to zoom in and if you're going to see them macro or microscopically, then this is how they look. They have got millions of asperities, very small peaks and valleys and ridges and small asperities. Okay, so as you saw in the surface roughness also, there are crest, there is peak, and there is valley, and then when they touch each other then they have a joining point, or a point which is called asperity contact. So when these two join, the peak of the one surface and the valley of the another surface, when they join, then this is called asperity contact. Okay, so when you see something microscopically, there are thousands of peaks and valleys, and then when they contact each other then they have an asperity contact. Okay, so if you are going to look at a surface, as an example is in this, then the plane surface looks like this, where the bottom peak is basically contacting the upper valley. Okay, so when matter is not smooth, so this is what it says, and there are some tiny irregularities which are stuck with each other. Okay, so over a very smooth surface the atoms can become very close. Okay, and then due to electrical forces and laws of attraction, maybe they can even join together. Okay, and when they slide after joining, then those bonds are broken, and because of those bonds are broken, there is a resistive force of friction which is generated. So you have to break those bonds to basically make something move relative to each other. So these are the jerks and jags which you experience when you put something on a rough surface. So there are two main theories. Number one is adhesion theory and number two is abrasion theory. So here in this figure, if you take a look at this figure, you can see that you've got two surfaces in part B. Okay, and you can see that there is an asperity contact, and that contact has some amount of area. So when you've got asperity contact, then there is some amount of area which has joined or welded. So when you've got two clean and dry surfaces, regardless of how smooth they are, there is going to be some fraction of contact between them. Okay, and in that case what happened is that the normal load which you saw, the normal load is supported by there is a normal force which is acting, and that is supported by very small dots. So although the surface is huge, but the whole load is not acting on the surface, the whole load is acting only on those small areas. So when there is a huge amount of load on the small areas, then what happens is that these asperities join due to cold welding, which you might have learned also. When you have a huge amount of pressure on two metal, between two metals, then cold weld occurs. Okay, so a bond is created. So these minute asperities, they are in contact with each other, and then what happens is that as the normal stress exceeds and the pushing force also exceed, then those joints are basically broken. Okay, this causes plastic deformation between these two areas. Okay, micro weld occurs. So elastic deformation occurs initially, and then when it breaks, then plastic deformation occurs before breaking, and this is the reason why friction develops due to micro welding, which occurs on the asperity contact. So this is one theory, adhesion theory. Next, we are going to move on to abrasion theory. So in abrasion theory, what happens is that it also says that we have got asperities, we have got asperity contacts. But what happens is that as there are a lot of asperities, then those asperities digs, okay, they plow the material, those very sharp thing, then when they are on the surface, then they plows and they do the digging action. When they do the digging action, then material is removed and friction is generated. So plowing is basically a process of removing something because of a very sharp thing which is in contact, and it is basically trying to remove the material. So plowing may cause displacement of the material, which occurs, and plowing produces some small chips or silvers, as in cutting and abrasive action. So these are some of the two main theories of friction: adhesive theory and abrasion theory. So if you take a look at this picture, this is a friction welding process in which friction is used to generate heat. But however, this is not real. This is basically a friction welding process which is which we want. We want friction to create heat to melt. However, this is not the case. If let's say the friction between your car tire and road increases so that it can melt the material, then your tire will burst out. So friction is very important, and it can be very dangerous that it can basically melt the material if the friction becomes too high. Friction causes amount of heat to generate in the form of usually heat, and that heat if increases can basically melt the material as well. In our case, in friction welding, as you can see, two parts are going to move relative to each other. The friction is going to increase the heat, and that heat is going to melt the material, and because of melting it will join the material. So because of friction, we can see heat energy is created and temperature difference is created. Next thing is that because of temperature, the microstructure or the material structure will change also. So if you are going to look at this picture, then this is the base material in which friction welding did not occur. Okay, after that, what happens is once the friction started, then that then you can see that the microstructure or the grain size has started to reduce. Okay, then what happens, continuous and discontinuous recrystallization occurs. What happens is that the new grains are formed, okay, small grains are created, and then they join to become large grains. Then furthermore, more nucleus is formed because of the heat, and because of the nucleation, when the nucleus grows, then it creates a grain. So these are something which occur. So the microstructure evolution is very related to the amount of heat which is present. So the interface temperature, the temperature between two surfaces, can be very high, and it can cause microstructural structural changes. So if you are using let's say your tire, and your tire microstructure changes, the structure of the rubber changes, then the strength or the properties of the rubber might change, and this may cause the rubber to not perform its function. That is why it is important that your car tire should withstand the amount of friction, and its structure should not change as well. So that is why in materials engineering, these properties are very important: the surface property, the roughness, the friction, the asperities, the friction coefficient, and these, and the total amount of heat which a material can withstand. These things are very important. So this is how friction can affect. It can affect the melting, it can affect the microstructure, it can affect the base material microstructure as well. So students, we are going to move on to our next section, which is the applications of friction. Where is it applicable? So friction, as you know, is in our everyday life. There are many engineering applications and in many engineering disciplines. For instance, in transportation sector, we have automobile brakes, which inherently rely on friction, because for slowing and converting the kinetic energy, we require friction. Then for rail adhesion, it is important that there is a grip between the rail and the rail. Then we have got road slipperiness. Okay, it is an important design factor for automobile. Slip friction is important. Road texture, the texture of the surface is also very important, that we have learned in the first topic. Then in household usage, if you have a matchstick and then you basically burn the match, then it relies on friction to generate heat and to burn the chemical. And then we've got sticky beds, so we basically use sticky beds for different types of stuffs, like for catching some rodents, etc., and to prevent something from slipping. So these are some of the applications of frictions. Sand is also placed on ice, and the reason why sand is placed on icy roads is because our cars need some friction to basically run smoothly. So the objective basically is to increase the friction coefficient between the tire and the road. So these are one of some of the small minute applications, although there are many in general in engineering applications. Now that we have covered applications, let's move on to how do we do testing of friction coefficient, especially in the field of manufacturing. In manufacturing field, we do forging, casting, extrusion, blanking, billeting, etc. There are many manufacturing steps which.
Over the past 50 years, tribology has greatly improved the motors and bearings that are vital in today's fast-moving world. Failure of just a single bearing could cause a plane to crash or a pump in a nuclear power station to stop working. Oil and grease are used to cut down the friction between moving parts. Without oil, your car engine would grind to a halt in seconds. The human body is a complex biological machine that also needs lubrication. Knees, hips, and elbows suffer rough treatment over lifetime. Damaged joints can now be replaced by artificial ones with hip replacement, one of the most common and most successful operations.
NCAP tribologists are heavily involved in improving the performance of artificial joints. This hip simulator can test 10 implants at once. It mimics 2.5 years of working in just 10 weeks. Water causes friction or drag on a body moving through it. The drag on a moving ship is enormous if the hull becomes filled with seaweed, slime, or barnacles. Expensive fuel is wasted and carbon dioxide emissions increases. From trains to turbines, household cars to artificial hips, tribology, the science of friction, lubrication, and wear is improving our quality of life. This is tribology.
Rely on friction coefficient and testing of the friction. So how is friction testing in manufacturing operations and for manufacturing processes? So the one of the most important and most famous one used is the ring compression test. In ring compression test, what happens is that I have got a ring. Okay, and that ring I am going to place between two plates, two flattened plates. So I'm going to place my ring between two plates and then I'm going to compress those plates. Now what happens is that deformation is going to occur in that hollow ring. Either the hollow ring internal diameter will reduce or it will increase, and the outer diameter might also change. So if the friction coefficient is zero, then both the inner and the outer diameter are basically of the ring expand if they were as a solid disk. So once I am going to compress, they will just expand inner as well and the outer as well. However, if the friction coefficient is present between these two plates, okay, and our test specimen, then what is going to happen is that with increasing friction, the internal diameter becomes smaller and the barreling occurs. What is barreling? We will see in the next slide. So here as an example, we have got one ring test specimen, and now I want to do ring compression test. Okay, now when I do ring compression test, then what happened is that with the increase in load, you can see that the internal diameter has started to reduce. So once the internal diameter reduces, then you know that the friction has started to increase. What is barreling and what it is all about? So basically barreling occurs when you have got you are applying a force with compressive force between a specimen, okay, as you can see in the figure. Then initially and in ideal condition, what should happen is that it should compress and it should basically become expand in the equal amount in the other directions as well, right? However, this is not the case. Under real condition, barrel occurs. This is basically the distribution of work. Deformation occurs in a barrel manner, okay, like the barrels you have seen, barrel for containers. So this is how the deformation occurs. Okay, same is the case for the ring compression test. Barreling occurs, as you can see, there is a slight curvature. If you can zoom in, and if you can see the in detail, then there is basically a slight barrel which has occurred. You can see in this example as well, in the schematic, that a barrel has occurred. So if you got good lubrication, then the amount of barrel will be lesser, and if you have got poor lubrication, means the friction has increased, then the barreling will be further even more. So ring compression test is generally basically a test which is used to determine how much there has been a change in inner diameter. So I've got initial diameter and then I've got a final diameter. So there has been a percentage reduction. So based on the percentage reduction of diameter, I can get the values of friction coefficient, percentage reduction in the diameter and percentage reduction in the height. So I've got tables, and these tables have been basically determined, these charts have been determined experimentally and by simulation, and based on that we can basically calculate the friction coefficient. For example, on the x-axis you can see the reduction in internal diameter, how much percentage the diameter is reduced. On the on the y-axis, on the x-axis you have reduction in height, and these are the friction coefficient lines. So wherever my reduction matches, then it is my friction coefficient. For instance, if you have got let's say 40% reduction in the diameter, and you have got 40% reduction in height, then you are going to basically intersect them on this line, and this line corresponds to a friction coefficient of 0.057. So this is how you get the friction coefficient in manufacturing processes. Friction coefficient for tribological application, for instance dry sliding wear and lubrication wear, depends on different types of other friction testing mechanism in which the relative motion occurs. Okay, those types of friction coefficient measurement and measuring apparatus are pin on disc, pin on plate, reciprocating sliding testing machine, sliding pin testing machine. So these are some of the different types of basically friction testing machines, and in the upcoming video I will show you some of the examples of the machine and how they measure. So here are some of the parameters that are used for basically doing a tribo testing. Hypertrophy testing is basically an equipment in which you can vary some of these parameters such as applied loads, scanning speed, temperature, duration, and you can get the data in the form of surface roughness. You can make the specimen rotary or moving. You can collect wear debris information, how much is the amount of debris which was generated. Then you can put the lubrication settings in the machine as well, for instance whether it will be lubricated or not, whether there is formulation or not. You can see whether the specimen basically works under vibration, electrical or magnetic field. So we have got a variety of tribo testing equipment to mimic the real world simulation. The objective is that our testing should be done under the same condition, almost to mimic the real world scenario. Here we have got an example of pin on disc unidirectional tribo testing equipment, in which we have got the pin, and that pin is basically made of a very strong material like carbide, silicon carbide, tungsten carbide, and then we apply a load on the specimen, and this pin is going to be our this pin is our specimen, and the disc is something that we rotate. Next we move on to the disc, and the disc is basically moving in the to and fro direction. We apply the load on the pin specimen that we want to test, for instance carbide or some kind of different type of coating system like plasma coating, cold spray coating, chemical vapor deposition coating, etc. Sometimes we put the coating on the disc and then we test the disc system as well. Next we move on to the twin disc rolling sliding, in which we've got two rollers and we roll them against each other to get the friction coefficient, the rolling friction coefficient. So these three are some of the different types of systems. Next we have got a ball on disc system. Here we can get the friction coefficient of basically a ball rotating while the disc is rotating and the ball is stationary. We can increase or decrease the normal load on the ball, and that will impute a wear scar. You can see a wear scar which has been generated. We can get the friction coefficient value. So the tribo testing equipment basically plots these kind of friction coefficient against time. So these are the cumulative time, this is the friction coefficient. So here we have got a different types of coating, and you can see there for different coating we have got different coefficient of friction. So this is carried out at room temperature, and then part B is carried out at if you look at this one, then part B, then it is at 400 degrees centigrade. So you can see that titanium aluminum nitride has a lot of jerky system for jerky fluid coefficient of friction, and whereas for chromium nitride it is stable for a while, then it significantly reduces and then remains stable, whereas for plasma nitride coating for after 4000 it becomes stable, before that it's not. So there are different types of analysis that we can do after you have done the tribo testing. These includes a kind of different material testing equipments such as optical profilometry, the 3D scanning system that we saw in the surface roughness class. Then we can go for hardness testing, micro hardness, macro hardness, nano hardness. It depends on the intender size. Then we have got scanning electron microscopy with elemental spectroscopy to identify what are the elements present in the on the friction surface, and has it changed, has carbon come up, has oxidation occurred. Then we do atomic force microscopy to go in great details on atomic level as to how the morphology, how the topography of the surface has changed, and how the wear scars has changed. Then we carry X-ray diffraction. X-ray diffraction is used to get the chemical phase, the phase which is formed. And then we've got nuclear magnetic resonance, we've got FTIR, Raman, so atomic absorption, something like that. These are things which are used for and getting to know about the changes in the bonding at the near surface region. So there are many post analysis, post material chemical phase analysis that can be done. Here as an example, you can see optical profilometry, in which you can see you've got a textured surface, and then you can see the wear scar, how much the amount of material has been removed. This is something that you guys need to see in the papers that I've given to you guys as well. So the scale on the scale shows basically how much is the variation in the surface roughness or in depth, and you can see that almost 800 to 900 nanometer of wear scar has been produced at the crest region. So this is optical microscopy or optical profilometry. Optical profilometry also gives us the values of SQ, RA, RZ, SA, SZ, something like that. So there are a lot of information that can be obtained. SQ meaning root mean square height, changes in the root mean square height in terms of the area. Then we can see SCM, scanning electron microscopy, of the phases that have changed, you know, what phase formed during the tribo testing, whether the phase has changed or not. Friction coefficient. So this was all about friction coefficient. First we went through the friction definition, then the formulas, then what is the theory behind friction, okay, how it affects different types of materials, then what is the apparatus which is used for testing friction for manufacturing applications, etc., and how friction affects the microstructure and temperature. So these are things which are very important for you guys to understand, and the mechanism behind the generation of friction. So this was all about the friction. Next we are going to move on to the wear testing, or how do we test wear, and what is wear itself, and what